Hello everyone, I'm Sunil Kumar BL, Associate Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Canara Engineering College. I'm handling Advanced Computer Architectures 17CS72. Textbook is Advanced Computer Architecture by Kai Ham and Naresh Jotwani. Reference book is Computer Architecture, a Quantitative Approach by John L. NSC and David A. Patterson.
Chapter 7, Multiprocessors and Multicomputers. Multiprocessor System Interconnect. Parallel processing demands the use of efficient system interconnects for fast communication among multiple processors and shared memory, I/O and peripheral devices. Hierarchical buses, crossbar switches and multi-stage networks are often used for this purpose. A generalized multiprocessor system is shown in the diagram. This architecture combines features from UMA, NUMA and COMA models. Each processor PI is attached to its own local memory and private cache. These multiple processors connected to a shared memory through inter-processor memory network. Processors share the access of I/O and peripheral devices through processor I/O network. Both IPMN and PION are necessary in a shared resource multiprocessor. An optional interprocessor communication network IPCN can permit processor communication without using shared memory. Network characteristics. The networks are designed with many choices like timing, switching, and control strategy. Like in case of dynamic network, the multiprocessor's interconnections are under program control. Timing. Two types, synchronous and asynchronous. Synchronous, controlled by a global clock which synchronizes all network activity. Asynchronous, use handshaking or interlock mechanisms for communication and especially suitable for coordinating devices with different speed. Switching methods, two types, circuit switching and packet switching. Circuit switching, a pair of communicating devices control the path for the entire duration of data transfer. Packet switching, large data transfers broken into smaller pieces, each of which can compete for use of the path. Network control, again two types, centralized and distributed. Centralized, global controller receives and acts on requests. Distributed, requests handled by local devices independently. Hierarchical bus systems. A bus system consists of a hierarchy of buses connecting various system and subsystem components in a computer. Each bus is formed with a number of signal, control, and power lines. Different buses are used to perform different interconnection functions. In general, the hierarchy of bus system are packaged at different levels as shown in the diagram, including local buses on boards, backplane buses, and IO buses. Local bus is implemented on printed circuit boards are called local buses. On a processor board, one often finds a local bus which provides a common communication path among major components mounted on the board. A memory board uses a memory bus to connect the memory with interface logic. An I/O board or network interface board uses a data bus. Each of these board buses consists of signal and utility lines. Backplane bus. A backplane is a printed circuit on which many connectors are used to plug in functional boards. A system bus consists of shared signal, path stand, utility lines, is built on backplane. This system bus provides a common communication path among all plug-in boards. I/O bus. Input-output devices are connected to a computer system through an I/O bus, such as SCSI, Small Computer System Interface bus. This bus is made of coaxial cables with taps connecting disks, printer, and other devices to a processor through an I/O controller. Special interface logic is used to connect various board types to the backplane bus. Hierarchical buses and caches. This is a multi-level tree structure in which the leaf nodes are processors and their private caches denoted PJ and C1J as shown in the diagram. These are divided into several clusters, each of which is connected through a cluster bus. An intercluster bus is used to provide communications among the clusters. Second level caches, denoted as C2I, are used between each cluster bus and intercluster bus. Each second level cache must have a capacity that is at least an order of magnitude larger than the sum of the capacities of all first level caches connected beneath it. Each single cluster operates on a single bus system. Snoopy bus coherence protocols can be used to establish consistency among first level caches belonging to the same cluster. Second level caches are used to extend consistency from each local cluster to the upper level. The upper level caches from another level of shared memory between each cluster and main memory modules connected to the intercluster buses. Most memory requests should be satisfied at the lower level caches. Intercluster cache coherence is controlled among the second level caches and the resulting effects are passed to the lower level. Ultramax multiprocessor architecture. The Ultramax had a two-level hierarchical bus architecture as shown in the diagram. The Ultramax architecture was very similar to that characterized by Wilson, except that the global nanobus was used only for intercluster communications. The shared memories were distributed to all clusters instead of being connected to the intercluster bus. The cluster caches formed the second level cache and performed the same filtering and cache coherence control for remote access as in Wilson's scheme. When an access request reached the top bus, it would be routed down to the cluster memory that matched it with the reference address. The idea of using bridges between multiprocessor clusters is to allow transactions initiated on a local bus to be completed on a remote bus. As shown in the diagram, multiple buses are used to build a very large system consisting of three multiprocessor clusters. The bus used in this example is Future Bus Plus, but the basic idea is more general. Bridges are used to interface the clusters. The main function of a bridge include communication protocol conversion, interrupt handling in split transactions, and serving as cache and memory agents. Crossbar switch and multiport memory. Single stage networks are sometimes called recirculating networks because data items may have to pass through the single stage many times. The crossbar switch and the multiport memory organization are both single stage networks. This is because even if two processors attempt to access the same memory module or I/O device at the same time, only one of the requests is serviced at a time. Multistage networks. Multistage networks consists of multiple stages of switch boxes and should be able to connect any input to any output. Multistage network is called blocking if the simultaneous connections of some multiple input or output pairs may result in conflicts in the use of switches or communication links. A non-blocking multistage network can perform all possible connections between inputs and outputs by rearranging its connections. Crossbar networks. Crossbar networks connect every input to every output through a cross point switch. A crossbar network is a single stage non-blocking permutation network. In N processor M memory system, N into M cross point switches will be required. Each cross point is a unary switch which can be open or closed, providing a point-to-point connection path between the processor and memory module. Cross-point switch design. Out of N cross-point switches in each column of N cross M crossbar mesh, only one can be connected at a time. Cross-point switches must be designed to handle the potential connection for each memory module. A crossbar switch avoids competition for bandwidth by using order of n square switches to connect n inputs to n outputs. Although high non-scalable crossbar switches are popular mechanism for connecting a small number of workstation, typically 20 or fewer. Each processor provides a request line, a read or write line, a set of address lines, and a set of data lines to a cross-point switch for a single column. The cross-point switch eventually responds with an acknowledgement when the access has been completed. Multiport memory. Since crossbar switches are expensive and not suitable for systems with many processors or memory modules, multiport memory can be used. A multiport memory module has multiple connection points for processors or I/O devices, and the memory controller in module handles the arbitration and switching that might otherwise have been accomplished by a cross-point switch. A two-function switch can assume only two possible states, namely state or exchange states. However, a four-function switch box can be any of four possible states. A multi-stage network is capable of connecting any input terminal to any output terminal. Multi-stage networks are basically constructed by so-called shuffle exchange switching elements, which is basically a 2 cross 2 crossbar. Multiple layers of these elements are connected and form the network. Multistage and combining networks. Multistage networks are used to build larger multiprocessor systems. We describe two multistage networks. One is Omega network and the other one is Butterfly network that have been built into commercial mechanisms.
Omega networks. An 8-input Omega network is shown in the diagram. In general, an N-input Omega network has log n to the base 2 stages. The stages are labeled from 0 to log n to the base 2 minus 1, from the input end to the output end. Data routing is controlled by inspecting the destination code in binary. When the ith higher order bit of the destination code is a 0, a 2 cross 2 switch at stage I connects the input to the upper output. Otherwise, the input is directed to the lower output. Two switch settings are shown in the figure A and B with respect to permutation pi 1 is equal to within the bracket 0, 7, 6, 4, 2, 1, 3, and 5. One more permutation pi 2 is given by within the bracket 0, 6, 4, 7, 3, and 1, 5, and 2 respectively. The switch setting in the figure A implements pi 1, which maps 0 to 7, 7 to 6, 6 to 4, 4 to 2, 2 to 0, 1 to 3, 3 to 1, and 5 to 5. Consider the routing of a message from input 001 to output 011. This involves the use of switches A, B, and C, since the most significant bit of the destination 011 is 0, switch A must be set straight so that input 001 is connected to the upper output.
The middle bit of 011 is a 1. Thus, input 4 to switch B is connected to the lower output with the crossover connection. The least significant bit in 011 is 1, implying a flat connection in switch C. Similarly, the switch A, E and D are set for routing a message from input 101 to output 101. There exist no conflict in all the switch settings needed to implement the permutation pi 1 in figure A. Now consider implementing the permutation pi 2 in the 8 input omega network as shown in the diagram B. Conflicts in switch settings do exist in three switches identified as F, G and H. The conflicts occurring at F are caused by the desired routing 000 to 110 and 100 to 111. Since both destination addresses have a leading bit 1, both inputs to switch F must be connected to the lower output. To resolve the conflicts, one request must be blocked. Similarly, we see conflict at switch G between 011 to 000 and 111 to 011, and at switch H between 101 to 001 and 011 to 000. At switches I and J, broadcast is used from one input to two outputs. The above example indicates the fact that not all permutations can be implemented in one pass through the Omega network. Butterfly networks. This class of network is constructed with crossbar switches as building blocks. Figure 7.10 shows two butterfly networks of different size. Figure A shows a 64 input butterfly network built with two stages. 2 is equal to log 64 to the base 8. Of 8x8 crossbar switches. The 8-way shuffle function is used to establish the interstage connections between stage 0 and stage 1. The figure B, a 3-stage butterfly network, is constructed for 512 inputs, again with 8x8 crossbar switches. Each of 64x64 boxes in figure B is identical to the two-stage butterfly network of figure A. In total, 16 8x8 crossbar switches are used in the figure A, and 16 into 8 plus 8 into 8, that is equal to 192, are used in figure B. Larger butterfly networks can be modularly constructed using more stages. Note that no broadcast connections are allowed in butterfly network, making these network a restricted subclass of Omega networks. The hotspot problem. When the network traffic is non-uniform, a hotspot may appear corresponding to a certain memory module being exclusively accessed by many processors at the same time. For example, a semaphore variable being used as a synchronization barrier may become a hotspot since it is shared by many processors. Hotspots may degrade the network performance significantly. In the NYU Ultra Computer and the IBM RP3 multiprocessor, a combining mechanism has been added to the Omega network. The purpose was to combine multiple requests heading for the same destination at switch points where conflicts are taking place. An atomic read, modify, write primitive fetch and add of X,E has been developed to perform parallel memory updates using the combining network. Fetch and add. This atomic memory operation is effective in implementing an N-way synchronization with a complexity independent of N. In a fetch and add of X,E operation, X is an integer variable in shared memory and E is an integer increment. When a single processor executes this operation, the semantics are as follows. Initially, X is assigned to temp. Then X is evaluated like temp plus E. Then it returns temp value. So overall picture of fetch and add function is X get modified and the previous value of X is being returned. When N processes attempt to fetch and add X,E, the same memory word simultaneously, the memory is updated only once following a serialization principle. The sum of n increments e1 plus e2 plus up to en is produced in any arbitrary serialization of the n requests. This sum is added to the memory word x, resulting in a new value x plus e1 plus e2 plus up to en. The value returned to the n requests are all unique depending on the serialization order followed. The net result is similar to a sequential execution of n fetch and add, but is performed in one individual operation. Two simultaneous requests are combined in a switch as shown in the diagram. One of the following operation will be performed if processor P1 executes answer 1 is equal to fetch and add of X,E1 and processor P2 executes answer 2 is equal to fetch and add of X,E2 simultaneously on the shared variable X. If the request from P1 is executed ahead of the P2, the following values are returned. Answer 1 is equal to X and answer 2 is equal to X plus E1. If the execution order is reversed, the following values are returned. Answer 1 is equal to X plus E2 and answer 2 is equal to X. Regardless of the executing order, the value X is equal to X plus E1 plus E2 is stored in the memory. It is the responsibility of the switch box to form the sum E1 plus E2, transmit the combined request fetch and add of X,E1 plus E2, store the value E1 or E2 in a wait buffer of the switch and return the value X and X plus E1 to satisfy the original request
fetch and add of x comma e1 and fetch and add of x comma e2 respectively, as shown in the diagram. Cache coherence problem. In a memory hierarchy for a multiprocessor system, data inconsistency may occur between adjacent levels or within the same level. For example, the cache and main memory may contain inconsistent copies of the same data object. Multiple caches may process different copies of the same memory block because multiple processors operate asynchronously and independently. Caches in a multiprocessing environment introduce the cache coherence problem. When multiple processors maintain locally cached copies of a unique shared memory location, and any local modification of the location can result in a globally inconsistent view of memory. Cache coherence schemes prevent this problem by maintaining a uniform state for each cached block of data. Cache inconsistencies caused by data sharing, process migration, or I/O are explained in the next slide. The cache inconsistency problem occurs only when multiple private caches are used. In general, three sources of the problem are identified: sharing of writable data, process migration, and I/O activity. Consider a multiprocessor with two processors, each using private cache and both sharing the main memory. Let X be a shared data element which has been referenced by both processors. Before update, the three copies of X are consistent. If processor P writes new data X dash into the cache, the same copy will be written immediately into the shared memory under a write-through policy. In this case, inconsistency occurs between the two copies X and X dash in the two caches. On the other hand, inconsistency may also occur when a write back policy is used, as shown on the right. The main memory will be eventually updated when the modified data in the cache are replaced or invalidated. The figure shows the occurrence of inconsistency after a process containing a shared variable X migrates from processor 1 to processor 2 using write back cache on the right. In the middle, a process migrates from processor 2 to processor 1 when using write-through caches. In both cases, inconsistency appears between the two cache copies labeled X and X dash. Special precautions must be exercised to avoid such inconsistencies. A coherence protocol must be established before processors can safely migrate from one processor to another. Diagram shows cache inconsistency after an I/O operation and a possible solution for the same. Many of the early commercially available multiprocessors used bus-based memory systems. A bus is a convenient device for ensuring cache coherence because it allows all processors in the system to observe
ongoing memory transactions. If a bus transaction threatens the consistent state of a locally cached object, the cache controller can take appropriate actions to invalidate the local copy. Protocols using this mechanism to ensure coherence are called Snoopy protocols, because each cache snoops on the transaction of the other caches. On the other hand, scalable multiprocessor systems interconnect processors using short point-to-point links in direct or multi-stage networks. Unlike the situation in buses, the bandwidth of these networks increases as more processors are added to the system. However, such networks do not have a convenient snooping mechanism and do not provide an efficient broadcast capability. In such systems, the cache coherence problem can be solved using some variant of directory schemes. Protocol approaches for cache coherence. One is Snoopy bus protocol and second one is directory based protocol. Now, first one, Snoopy bus protocol. Snoopy protocol achieve data consistency among the caches and the shared memory through a bus watching mechanism. In the following diagram, two Snoopy bus protocols create different results. Consider three processors P1, P2, and PN maintaining consistent copies of block X in their local caches as shown in the diagram A and in the shared memory module marked X. Using a write invalidate protocol, the processor P1 modifies its cache from X to X dash, and all other copies are invalidated via the bus. Invalidated blocks are called dirty, meaning they should not be used. The write update protocol, as shown in diagram C, demands the new block content X dash be broadcast to all cache copies via the bus. The memory copy also update if write through cache are used. In using write back caches, the memory copy is updated later at block replacement time. Write through caches. The states of a cache block copy change with respect to read, write, and replacement operations in the cache shows the state transition for two basic write invalidate Snoopy protocols developed for write through and write back caches respectively. A block copy of a write through cache I attached to processor I can assume one of two possible cache states. They are valid or invalid. A remote processor is denoted J, where J is not equal to I. For each of the two cache states, six possible events may take place. Note that all cache copies of the same block use the same transition graph in making state changes. In a valid state, the diagram A shows all processors can read R of Y, R of J safely. Local processor I can also write W of I safely in a valid state. The invalid state corresponds to the case of the block either being invalidated or being replaced, that is Z of I
और जेड ऑफ जे। राइट बैक कैशेस, द वैलिड स्टेट ऑफ अ राइट बैक कैश कैन बी फर्दर स्प्लिट इन टू टू कैश स्टेट्स लेबल्ड आर डब्ल्यू रीड राइट एंड आर ओ रीड ओनली एज शोन इन द डायग्राम बी। द INV invalid or not in cash state is equivalent to the invalid state mentioned before. This three-state coherence scheme corresponds to an ownership protocol. When the memory owns a block, cache can contain only the RO copy of the block. In other words, multiple copies may exist in the RO state and every processor having a copy called keeper of the copy can read R of I, R of J safely. The INV state entered whenever a remote processor writes W of J, its local copy, or the local processor replaces, that is Z of I, its own block copy. The RW state corresponds to only one cache copy existing in the entire system owned by the local processor I. Read R of I and write W of I can be safely performed in the RW state from either the RO state or the INV state. The cache block becomes uniquely owned when a local write W of I takes place. Write once protocol. James Goodman proposed a cache coherence protocol for bus-based multiprocessors. This scheme combines the advantage of both write-through and write-back invalidations. In order to reduce bus traffic, the very first write of a cache block uses a write-through policy. This will result in a consistent memory copy while all other cache copies are invalidated. After the first write, shared memory is updated using a write-back policy. This scheme can be described by a four-state transition graph as shown in the diagram. The four cache states are defined as below. Valid. The cache block, which is consistent with the memory copy, has been read from shared memory and has not been modified. Invalid. The block is not found in the cache or it's inconsistent with the memory copy. Reserved. Data has been written exactly once since being read from shared memory. The cache copy is consistent with the memory copy, which is the only other copy. Then dirty. The cache block has been modified or written more than once, and the cache copy is the only one in the system, thus inconsistent with all other copies. Directory-based protocol. A write invalidate protocol may lead to heavy bus traffic caused by read misses resulting from the processor updating a variable and other processors trying to read the same variable. On the other hand, the write update protocol may update data items in remote caches which will never be used by other processors. In fact, these problems pose additional limitations in using buses to build large multiprocessors. When a multi-stage or packet-switched network is used to build a large multiprocessor with hundreds of processors, the Snoopy cache protocol must be modified to suit the network capabilities. Since broadcasting is expensive to perform in such a network, consistency commands will be sent only to those caches that keep a copy of block. This leads to directory-based protocols for network-connected multiprocessors. Directory structures. In a multistage or packet-switched network, cache coherence is supported by using cache directories to store information on where copies of each cache block reside. Various directory-based protocols differ mainly in how the directory maintains information and what information it stores. The directory scheme, which used a central directory containing duplicates of all cache directories. This central directory providing all the information needed to enforce consistency is usually very large and must be associatively searched, like the individual cache directories. Contention and long search times are two drawbacks in using a central directory for large multiprocessors. A distributed directory where each memory module maintains a separate directory which records the state and presents information for each memory block. The state information is local, but the presence information indicates which cache have a copy of the block. A read miss in cache 2 results in a request sent to memory module, as shown in diagram A. The memory controller retransmits the request to the dirty copy in cache 1. This cache writes block its copy. The memory module can supply a copy to the requesting cache. In the case of a write hit at cache 1, a command is sent to memory controller which sends invalidation to all caches. For example, cache 2 marked in the presence vector residing in the directory D1. A cache coherence protocol that does not use broadcast must store the locations of all cached copies of each block of shared data. This list of cached locations, where centralized or distributed, is called a cache directory. A directory entry for each block of data consists a number of pointers to specify the location of copies of the block. Each directory entry also contains a dirty bit to specify whether a particular cache has permission to write the associated block of data. Different types of directory protocols fall under three primary categories: full map directories, limited directories, and chained directories. Full map directories store enough data associated with each block in global memory so that every cache in the system can simultaneously store a copy of any block of data. That is, each directory entry contains n pointers, where n is the number of processors in the system. Full map directories. The full map protocol implements directory entries with 1 bit per processor and a dirty bit. Each bit represents the state of the block in the corresponding processor's cache. If the dirty bit is set, then one and only the processor's bit is set, and that processor can write into the block. A cache maintains 2 bits of state per block. 1 bit indicates whether a block is valid, and the other bit indicates whether a valid block may be written. The cache coherence protocol must keep the state bits in the memory directory and those in the cache consistent. Figure A illustrates 3 different state of a full map directory. In the first state, the location X is missing in all of the caches in the system. The second state results from 3 caches C1, C2 and C3 requesting copies of location X. 3 pointers are set in the entry to indicate the caches that have copies of the block of data. In the first 2 states, the dirty bit on the left side of the directory entry is set to clean, indicating that no processor has permission to write to the block of data. The third state results from cache C3 requesting write permission for block. In the final state, the dirty bit is set to dirty and there is a single pointer to the block of data in cache C3. Let us examine the transition from the second state to the third state in more details. Once processor P3 issues the write to cache C3, the following events will be taking place. 1. Cache C3 deletes the block containing location X is valid, but that the processor does not have permission to write to the block, indicated by the block's write permission bit in the cache. 2nd one, cache C3 issues a write request to the memory module containing location X and stalls processor P3. 3rd one, the memory module issues invalidate request to cache C1 and C2. 4th one, cache C1 and C2 receives the invalidate request, set the appropriate bit to indicate that the block containing location X is invalid, and send acknowledgements back to the memory module. 5th, the memory module receives the acknowledgement, sets the dirty bit, clears the pointers to caches C1 and C2, and sends write permission to cache C3. 6th, cache C3 receives the write permission message, updates the state in the cache, and reactivates processor P3. Limited directories. Limited directory protocols are designed to solve the directory size problem, restricting the number of simultaneously cached copies of any particular block of data limits the growth of the directory to a constant factor. A directory protocol can be classified as DIRIX. The symbol I stands for number of pointers and X is NB for a scheme with no broadcast. A full map scheme without broadcast is represented as DIRNNB. A limited directory protocol that uses I less than N pointers is denoted DIRINB. The limited directory protocol is similar to the full map directory, except in the case when more than I caches request read copies of a particular block of data. Figure B shows the situation when three caches request read copies in a memory system with DIR2NB protocol. In this case, we can view the two-pointer directory as a two-way set associative cache of pointers to shared copies. When cache C3 requests a copy of location X, the memory module must invalidate the copy in either cache C1 or cache C2. This process of pointer replacement is called eviction. Since the directory acts as a set associative cache, it must have a pointer replacement policy. If the multiprocessor exhibits processor locality in the sense that in any given interval of time, only a small subset of all the processors access a given memory word, then a limited directory is sufficient to capture this small worker set of processors. Chained directories. Chained directories realize the scalability of limited directories without restricting the number of shared copies of data blocks. This type of cache coherence scheme is called chained scheme because it keeps track of shared copies of data by maintaining a chain of directory pointers. The simpler of two schemes implements a singly linked chain, which is best described by the example shown in diagram C. Suppose there are no shared copies of location X. If processor P1 reads location X, the memory sends a copy to cache C1. Along with chain termination CT pointer. The memory also keeps a pointer to cache C1. Subsequently, when processor P2 reads location X, the memory sends a copy to cache C2 along with pointer to cache C1. The memory then keeps pointer to cache C2. By repeating the above step, all the caches can cache a copy of location X. If processor P3 writes to location X, it is necessary to send a data invalidation message down the chain to ensure sequential consistency. The memory module denies processor P3 write permission until the processor with the chain termination pointer acknowledges the invalidation of the chain. Perhaps this scheme should be called a gossip protocol as opposed to Snoopy protocol, because information is passed from invalid, sorry, information is passed from individual to individual rather than being spread by covert observation. The possibility of cache block replacement complicates chained directory protocols. Suppose that cache C1 through CN all have copies of location X, and that location X and location Y maps to the same directory mapped cache line. If processor PI reads location Y, it must first evict location X from its cache with following possibilities. 1. Send a message down the chain to cache CI minus 1 with a pointer to cache CI plus 1 and splice CI out of the chain. Or, second one, invalidate location X in cache CI plus 1 through cache CN. Hardware synchronization mechanisms. Synchronization is a special form of communication in which control information is exchanged instead of data between communicating processes residing in the same or different processors. Synchronization enforces correct sequencing of processors and ensures mutually exclusive access to shared writable data. Synchronization can be implemented in software, firmware, and hardware through controlled sharing of data and control information in memory. Atomic operations. Most multiprocessors are equipped with hardware mechanisms for enforcing atomic operations, such as memory read, write, or read modify write operations, which can be used to implement some synchronization primitives. Besides atomic memory operations, some interprocessor interrupts can be used for synchronization purpose. For example, the synchronization primitives test and set of lock and reset of lock are defined below. Test and set of lock body contains temp is equal to lock, lock is equal to 1, then returns temp. Reset of lock as the code which assigns 0 for lock. Test and set is implemented with atomic read modify write memory operation. To synchronize concurrent processes, the software may repeat test and set until returned value of temp becomes 0. This synchronization primitive may tie up some bus cycles while a processor enters busy waiting on the spin lock. To avoid spinning, interprocessor interrupts can be used. A lock tied to an interrupt is called suspend lock. Using such a lock, a process does not relinquish the processor while it is waiting. Whenever the process fails to open the lock, it records its status and disables all interrupts aiming at the lock. When the lock is open, it signals all waiting processors through an interrupt. Concurrent processes residing in different processors can be synchronized using barriers. A barrier can be implemented by a shared memory word which keeps counting the number of processes reaching the barrier. After all processes have updated the barrier counter, the synchronization point has been reached. No processor can execute beyond the barrier until the synchronization process is complete. Wired barrier synchronization. A wired NOR logic is shown in figure for implementing a barrier mechanism for fast synchronization. Each processor uses a dedicated control vector X and access a common monitor vector Y in shared memory, where M corresponds to barrier lines used and X is indicated with X1, X2 up to XM and Y is indicated with Y1, Y2 up to YM. The number of barrier lines needed for synchronization depends on the multiprogramming degree and the size of the multiprocessor system. Each control bit XI is connected to the base of a probing transistor. The monitor bit YI checks the collector voltage of the transistor. Each barrier line is wired NOR to N transistors from N processors. Whenever bit XI is raised to high, the corresponding transistor is closed, pulling down the level of barrier line I. The wired NOR connection implies that line I will be high only if control bit XI from all processors are low. This demonstrates the ability to use the control bit XI to signal the completion of a process on processor I. The bit XI is set to 1 when process is initiated and reset to 0 when the process finishes its execution. When all processes finishes their job, the XI bit from the participating processors are all set to 0 and the barrier line is then raised to high, signaling the synchronization barrier has been crossed. This timing is watched by all processors through snooping on the bit YI. Thus, only one barrier line is needed to monitor the initiation and completion of a single synchronization involving many concurrent processes. Multiple barrier lines can be used simultaneously to monitor several synchronization points. Diagram shows wired barrier synchronization of 5 partially ordered processes. Thank you.